Welcome to Jags Drive Time with Ashlyn Sullivan, John Oehser, and Brian Sexton. Jags Drive Time starts right now.
Let's go, boys. Let's go, boys. Come on, Rock. Come on, Rock.
Arms it into the open field, 40, 35, 30, 25. Rock Armstead, best run of the year for him.
Hey, Rock! Hey, Rock! Ah! Look at my dog! Look at my dog! Fourth quarter, though. Let's win this, Trev. Got to win this, bro. Come on, man. Yep. Where the f*** is he going? Where the f*** is you going? Win on three.
Dare Agumbawale mic'd up against the Colts. That's a happy sideline on Sunday. You can check out all the mic'd up features always on Jaguars.com. That episode up there now. Go watch it. Welcome into Jaguars Drive Time. It is Wednesday. It is our last show of the 2020 season. 2021? What year is it? I don't even know.
It's 2022.
It's the last show.
And I have to say, I'm so grateful for that win on Sunday, to be able to go into the offseason with that clip there,
yep.
Right, with some positive energy about what the offseason is. If we had had to go through 9 consecutive losses and just sort of scrape by this week, it wouldn't have been much fun.
No.
So at least it gives it a burst and people can be excited and happy about it.
Yeah,
Mr. Positivity.
Here he goes.
I don't know that it
now
was,
he starts.
There's 9 games were that fun, but I feel you.
I didn't say the 9 games were. I said the last one makes it more fun.
It's
you
so
don't
much,
listen. You don't listen at all.
Sherry says that every
day. Yesterday you had me making the playoffs, them making the playoffs, and all I said was be in contention, and today you're like, 9 games fun. No, one. One game was fun, John.
What?
My dad always does that. It's so annoying, the dad
jokes.
Well,
John enjoys that.
Gosh.
I got nothing.
Good morning, John.
How are you?
I'm fantastic. Last show and ready to roll.
Let's go.
We've come a long way. Let's get to big things. We're taking a big picture look at this past season and what the Jaguars need to do to get much better next year. Big thing one is offense. You have a franchise quarterback. We know that. But other than that, there's a lot of questions. Running back, offensive line, wide receiver. But if you get this guy back, Travis Etienne, you're feeling a little better.
It actually was the hardest, I think. Being in meetings every day, it helped me in a way, helped me in a sense, because I felt that I was a part of it. I felt like I was a part of everything. I was like a little kid going to the birthday, but I just couldn't have any birthday cake. That's the best way I could put it. That's how this year been for me. And so next year, I'm just looking forward to just indulging all the cake that I can.
Love that analogy. Big thing, too, is defense. We talked about it yesterday on yesterday's show. You need interior defensive line. You probably need another pass rusher, but you feel good about linebacker and you feel good about cornerback, especially because of this guy, Tyson Campbell, and the development throughout this past season.
The beginning of the season was a little bit of growth pain, getting used to, the speed of the game and, finding myself in the defense. I stuck with, kept working hard, kept trusting my position coaches, Coach Walt, Coach Joe Danner. And just kept pushing, man. Just never gave up. Just having faith in God that, eventually it's all going to come together for me. And when it did, of course, I stayed humble and stayed, focused. And the main goal was to just get better each and every week. And then I just took it that way. And then I took it as, a day-by-day mindset. Just trying to find something to get better at each and every day.
And finally, big thing three is coaching. The biggest question mark of all, who will be the Jaguars' next head coach? There are reported interviews today and Friday. But one thing we do know is this locker room got closer through all the adversity of this season.
Yeah, I would say we all kind of felt the same way in terms of we're going through, one of the hardest things you could see in the league, where it's like coaching changes and a losing streak and things like that. So we kind of understood this is one of the worst things we'll see in our time, but we're getting in our first year, so we're getting out the way. So I think we kind of all bonded in that sense. And, me and Tyson grew close together because we're both DBs. And so I think we grew a real close bond as a class.
And there you have it. Those are big things. That was the first opportunity we got to speak to all of those guys at once. And looking back at that sound, you realize if all three of those guys pan out, you're much closer than you think.
Without a doubt. We talked yesterday about how Trevor Lawrence's big game gave a lot of those guys a chance to have their best games, right? For the defensive guys in particular, the ability to play with a lead and the pass rush set up Andre Sisko to have a better game. I mean, all of those things kind of factor into it. Let's go back to the top real quick. Offense, what they need, what you want from this. I know wide receiver and speed down the field is the number one pressing need. But, I mean, really close behind it is you're going to need another running back. Trevor said he's ahead of schedule and he'll be ready to go. Of course he's going to say that, right? But that's a major injury for a running back. I can only think of one player in Jaguars history that strikes me as having had the Achilles, and it was Reggie Hayward, the defensive end. And he was good, but he was never the same explosiveness. And James Robinson's not a fast guy as it is, so now how does his game adjust? You're going to have to need another one. I think running back is a critical area for this, and whoever the coach is probably going to agree with that, because you can't have those two injuries and those two backs and say we're okay there.
Yeah, it has to be a situation where you look at those two guys and hope that they are back to 100%. I don't think you can go into the offseason unless you're sure with the doctors.
Yeah.
They're going to be 100%, and I don't know how you can be at this point. The draft class, and that was Sisko, Etienne, and
Campbell.
Mm-hmm. If those three guys pan out, you're much closer. I don't think we've seen enough out of any of them. I mean, Campbell, I think we have. I think he is bare minimum a starting level corner.
Right.
Is he a number one takeaway the other guy? I don't think we know that yet. But bare minimum, you can start building around him. You can start building around Trevor. Sisko, we've seen for a couple games. He looked good making some plays on the ball. The word is he needs to be more physical. So the good with the improvement.
Sure.
So you hope these draft guys work out.
On the defensive side of the ball, at times this year they were better against – well, they're certainly better against the run than they were last year.
Just, yeah.
You know, take away some of those games where they were trailing helplessly and in the second half teams just pounded them. When early on, and we saw it especially in the two games against Jonathan Taylor, they played okay against the run. But you got to get better up the middle on the run. I mean, you got to have the tackle that you talked about yesterday, and you're going to need another safety. And I think Rayshon Jenkins is a good player. He's not a great player. And you'd like to, if you could, find a safety that can come in here, whether it's free agency or the draft, and give you that thumper in the middle of the field, that guy that can play near the box and really give you the run-stuffing ability.
I think what Brian touched on is something that the entire roster has to be looked at, in the sense of, I talked about offensive line last couple of weeks. They have five players who are all NFL caliber starters.
Right.
You have no problem as a GM having any of those guys start for you. But is there greatness in that group?
Yeah.
They haven't shown that. That's much the same with a lot of guys on the roster. I think Rayshon Jenkins, the safeties, they are perfectly fine NFL players. How do you get to the point where you have impacting above the X's and O's playmaking guys? That's what they've got to have. They don't have enough of them. Trevor and Josh Allen look like they can be those guys. James Robinson went healthy. Beyond that, yeah. I don't know that you have it.
You got to go find them. One other area of concern, and that is the offensive line from a perspective of numbers. Because when you look at the offensive line, Cam Robinson is not on your roster or salary cap as of this moment for 2022. Andrew Norwell is gone. Tyler Shatley is a free agent. AJ Cann is a free agent. So, I mean, right now, if you had to put a starting offensive line next year, who do you have to choose from? Juwan Taylor, Ben Bartsch. You've got Brandon Linder on the roster. See what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, then it drops off to the Casey McDermott, and he's not a starting level offensive lineman. Well, you got Walker Little as
right.
well.
So you've got four, but they need to, you know.
Well, and are those guys all in the right places? I know Juwan Taylor said on Monday he's not an offensive guard. I think he is.
Which I don't blame him for saying, though.
Of course he's going
to say that.
That's
what he's supposed to say.
A, yeah. Pride in himself in his position.
Absolutely.
B, tackles make more than guards. So I'd say that too. But he's led the league in holding penalties the last 3 years, which might indicate he didn't have the footwork to get out there and get those guys, which is why I say put him in his brute strength inside. Well, I think he could be a Pro Bowl-level guard, maybe even better, maybe one of the better guards in the AFC. I think he's that talented as an offensive lineman. I just don't see him as a right tackle.
Yes.
But you get my point. You got a lot of mixing and matching. You got to figure the offensive line out. So when you talk about the roster as a whole, right. There are a lot of situations that people aren't contemplating.
Yes, there's a lot of work to be done, including hiring a new head coach. The next guest we have on Jaguars Drive Time will have some insight on that. Judy Batista joins the show next from NFL.com. Stay with us here on Jaguars Drive Time.
Jags Drive Time is brought to you by TIAA Bank. Turn potential into progress. And by Publix, where shopping is a pleasure. Your family isn't like anyone else's. Your home shouldn't be either. At Dreamfinders Homes, you can build the home of your dreams in one of their 30-plus communities in Northeast Florida. Choose from luxury single-family homes or maintenance-free townhomes from the 200s. Dreamfinders specializes in homes built to fit your lifestyle. To find out more, call 904-738-0165 or visit dreamfindershomes.com.
At ByStar Credit Union, you inspire us to deliver on our promise, to do good for our members and our communities. That's why we offer more banking options, like better rates and no hidden fees. We also give back, donating several million dollars to hundreds of nonprofits each year. Better financial lives, stronger communities. ByStar Credit Union. Do good. Bank better. Visit bystarcu.org/join. Insured by NCUA.
Hi folks, Frank Franzi here to tell you where to find the most authentic Southern Pit barbecue in all of Jacksonville. That's right, Bono's. For 72 years, Bono's has been smoking real pit barbecue right here on the First Coast. Smoked for hours, served in minutes, and always cut to order. You can find Bono's locations all around town and on game day at TIAA Bank Field. Bono's is the official barbecue of the Jacksonville Jaguars. If you want great barbecue, head to Bono's today. If you don't see a pit, it ain't legit.
Over 30 communities to choose from with the best selection of move-in ready homes. Quality, value, personalization. That's the Dreamfinders Homes difference. Visit dreamfindershomes.com. We're back, Jaguars Drive Time. It is Wednesday, our last show of the season as the Jaguars gear up to hire a new head coach, most likely here in the next week or two. And NFL.com's columnist Judy Batista joins the show right now for her insight. Good morning, Judy. It is crazy to think after one short year, the Jaguars are right back here and the head coach news is dominating the conversation.
Yeah, but you know what? As we look around the league, I think we realize that if you realize that you've made a mistake, the best thing to do is to cut your losses and move on quickly. And that's obviously what they decided in Jacksonville. I am curious to see now that, we've gotten past the end of the regular season and other teams have moved on from their coaches. You know, you usually see like things really pick up steam because teams are sort of racing each other. They worry that they're going to get shut out of the top candidates and then the top candidates for the assistant coaching staff. So usually once we get past Monday, you really start to see teams take off on interviews and making decisions.
Good morning, Judy. I know Byron Leftwich from his time here, but I don't know the other candidates personally very well. I think this franchise needs a Mike Vrabel kind of coach. A tough guy, but a guy that connects with the organization. Is there one of those guys? Is that Dan Quinn? Who's the most Mike Vrabel-like guy of the coaching candidates, if you could identify one?
That's a good question, because Mike Vrabel is a unique combination of former player and, you know, fairly recent former player. He's a tough guy. You know, he played linebacker, so you think he's more on the defensive side of the ball. But he has, as you said, really connected well with the entire organization, and I think has brought sort of a culture to that franchise that was missing, sort of toughness and grittiness and resilience, which has certainly been borne out by their play this year. I don't know if there is a Mike Vrabel in this group, to be honest. I think the candidates that we're seeing are impressive. Most of them seem to be coming from the offensive side of the ball, which is probably not surprising with the emphasis on offense, what it is. And certainly because, you know, the number one thing has to be that either the head coach or whoever is going to be the offensive coordinator has to be really strong at quarterback development, because you've got a gem there in Trevor Lawrence and you want to do everything you can to nurture him and get everything you can out of him. Nathaniel Hackett is really well regarded from Green Bay. Obviously, his work with Aaron Rodgers is a really bright line on a resume, would be for anybody. He's really well regarded, though, as a guy who does connect with players. He's like sort of a really interesting guy. Like, he taught a hip hop dance class, you know, when he was in school. So he's an interesting, fun guy. And so that may be that part of, you know, connecting with the locker room. Certainly Byron Leftwich, again, a recent player, right? I mean, he came off the field not that long ago. Bruce Arians has been talking about him as a future head coaching candidate since Byron was still playing. So I think he is going to come, you know, with a lot of people interested in him. And if it doesn't happen for him this year, I think he'll be in the pipeline for a number of years to come. But, you know, to get that Mike Vrabel guy, let's be honest, we didn't know Mike Vrabel was going to be this successful when he was hired. Like, it felt a little bit like a leap when they hired him, and it has panned out spectacularly. And I think, you know, so much of this is not just what they have done on the field with a team. It's the feel you get for a candidate, and, you know, that, and how he meshes with whoever your general manager is going to be, and with ownership, and how you think he'll connect to players. And so much of that is just gut. And you've got to hope that the people who are making the decision, who are in those meetings for the Jaguars, you know, get the feeling for the right guy. And look, we see it all over the league every year. There are a lot of mistakes made. It's hard to find a good head coach in the NFL.
Judy, in that vein, I'm going to ask you an impossible question, which I do
awesome.
A lot. So, you know, you've been doing this a long time, as have I, and have seen a lot of coaches work and not work. Is there one trait that comes close to defining what can make a guy work, or are there too many moving parts organizationally, personality wise, play? I mean, but is there a trait that you like in a head coach?
This is going to sound trite, but I think a head coach has to be a really good communicator, and he has to be able to communicate not just with other coaches. He's got to be able to communicate well with ownership. He's got to be able to communicate with his locker room. You know, and frankly, he's the public face of the franchise. He's got to be able to communicate with the media, because that's how you communicate with fans. So I think if there's a number one thing, I mean, obviously you want him to be a strong X's and O's guy. That's a baseline. But I think if you're looking for a character part of it, he's got to be able to communicate, and he's got to be able to command a room. You know, Tom Coughlin, who, of course, we all know from Jacksonville and New York, you know, people thought he did not connect with players, and he changed his ways, right? I mean, the Giants management told him, like, you've got to, you know, let them see the grandfather in you, let them see that guy. And he did. And those Giants players that he coached are immensely loyal to Tom Coughlin because of that. And I think is what has to happen with coaches. They need to connect, because they're going to have to get teams through some tough days. I mean, again, going back to Mike Vrabel, like, you know, when Derrick Henry goes out, let's face it, all of us around the country thought, well, that's the end of the Titans. And somehow he got those guys to believe, like, we can plow through this. We can keep going, and we're going to be okay. And that's what you need, right? It's leadership, but you need somebody who can connect with all the different factions, because being a head coach in the NFL is complicated. Like, every person I've ever talked to about what being a head coach is like in the NFL, they are astonished by the things that cross their desk, right? Like, there's just an avalanche of stuff they have to address, from players and owners. And sometimes you're dealing with the marketing people, and you're dealing with business side, and you've got agents in your ear. I mean, there's all kinds of stuff, and they have to be able to deal with all those different factions and know how to juggle them. It's a CEO job in the NFL now, and you've got to have CEO level skills.
Hey, Judy, Joe Judge obviously was fired by the Giants last night, so that's 7 openings. How does that impact the coaching cycle, or the coaching hiring cycle all of a sudden? Do you suppose we're going to see teams making quicker decisions because you're going to be fighting for the coach you want and him for his assistants? Or do you think it doesn't have much impact at all?
I do think it has an impact. I think I wish it didn't, but you do see teams, I don't want to say they're panicking, but they speed up because they are afraid, you know, if they've got their eye on the number one candidate that they want, they're afraid that, you know, are the Giants going to request talking to this guy? We got to jump in. The late Dan Rooney, who had an impeccable record of hiring head coaches, he hired Mike Tomlin and he hired Chuck Knoll and he hired Bill Cowher, and those things worked out really well for them. He always implored his fellow owners to slow down and cast a wide net and not be rushed. Don't be rushed by fans begging for a new head coach. Don't be rushed by the sense that other people are getting stuff done and so you need to get stuff done too. Don't be rushed by the media. He said, slow down and cast a wide net and talk to a lot of people. And that worked really well for them. That's how they got Mike Tomlin. But, you know, I think it's human nature for people, once you start seeing other teams jump in, that you feel like, we better hurry because we're going to miss out. And I guess I hope for everybody's sake that everybody takes a deep breath and really thinks through these decisions, because they are, you know, it's not just Jacksonville. We see it all over the league. These are huge decisions and it's really easy to get them wrong.
Mm-hmm. A deep breath is absolutely needed right now. Maybe a nap as well. It's craziness here in Jacksonville. Yeah. Judy, thank you for your time. We very much appreciate it this morning.
Thank you, Judy.
Great to see you, Judy.
When we come back on Jaguars Drive Time Summit, this or that coming up on the Jaguars Digital Network.
Jags Drive Time is presented in part by Dreamfinders Homes, homes that fit your lifestyle, and Baptist Health, changing healthcare for good. Your family isn't like anyone else's. Your home shouldn't be either. At Dreamfinders Homes, you can build the home of your dreams in one of their 30-plus communities in Northeast Florida. Choose from luxury single-family homes or maintenance-free townhomes from the 200s. Dreamfinder specializes in homes built to fit your lifestyle. To find out more, call 904-738-0165 or visit dreamfindershomes.com.
Move day is on the 20, the 10. Yes, another successful move to a new home. I tell you, folks, I've never seen a team more prepared than the Move Day crew. With a dominating lead in training, trust, and moving efficiency, it's no wonder why Move Day is the official moving company of the Jacksonville Jaguars. Track your goods online and get updated play-by-plays throughout your move process. While the Jags are moving the chains on game day, they're here to help you on moving day. Call 844-MY-MOVE-DAY or visit movedaymovers.com.
At ByStar Credit Union, you inspire us to deliver on our promise, to do good for our members and our communities. That's why we offer more banking options, like better rates and no hidden fees. We also give back, donating several million dollars to hundreds of nonprofits each year. Better financial lives, stronger communities. ByStar Credit Union. Do good. Bank better. Visit bystarcu.org/join. Insured by NCUA.
Price.com is the easiest way to save money with comparison shopping, cashback, coupons, all in one. It's free. Try Price.com today.
It was great to have the leaders and the people in our locker room that we had to really keep the team together, because there was, it was hard, you know. So, and I took pride on myself to make sure I can't. You know, get in one of those moments to where I'm going off, and you know, because everybody's following me. You know, so it's good for, you know, it was good for me and a lot of leaders on this team to really just keep the young guys and like, hey, you know, this is not the NFL. Don't think this is like the NFL. Like, we have to. This is what you do. Follow me in this, and like, don't do this and do this and follow. You know, follow here and stuff like that. So the leaders on our team within the locker room did an amazing job.
Ben Jones post-game Sunday against the Colts, I thought it was really telling when he said, this is not like the NFL. And it was true. This year was so crazy. I think it needed to be said that this is not normal for this to happen, and they needed a guy like that this year.
10 years in the league, you would know.
Absolutely.
It was a staggering quote.
Yeah.
And I'll leave it back.
Staggering quote. Yeah. All right. It is time for This or That, presented by Price.com.
this.
I apologize. I stepped all over Joe's music. How embarrassing.
It's all right.
Brian, what do you got for this or that?
They're locked in at number one, and depending on who you listen to, the people I listen to tell me that there are three offensive tackles and two defensive ends that are going to go in the top five, right? A quarterback is not going to shoot up. A wide receiver is not going to shoot up. There's not a running back there. This top of the draft is offensive linemen and defensive linemen, which is good for teams because they need these, right? So what do you want? You want an offensive tackle or a defensive end? Because no one's coming up to trade with you at number one, especially not when there's multiple at each one of these positions.
Yeah.
They'll just stay where they're at and hold on to their draft capital. So you're going to be picking number one, and you're going to be taking an offensive tackle or a defensive end. So who's it going to be?
I want defensive end. Okay. Because here's my situation that I'm playing out in my head. You keep Cam Robinson, you sign him to another franchise, and then you move Walker Little. I think that's what's going to happen because Jawan Taylor I don't think is going to pan out at right tackle. If Walker Little can move over, then I think you're not set, but you feel better about that than defensive end right now.
John?
Yeah, I'll go the other way because I keep thinking, maybe it's a little recency bias because the two defensive ends did not show out in the bowl game. So I'm probably playing into that a little bit. But I keep going back to what I've said about the offensive line for a couple of weeks now. How do you get great? It appears that there are more rock solid, can't miss, I hate the word, but that guy at offensive line than defensive line. So maybe the approach is we're going to get great at a position and then let the other players that we have be good around him and start building toward that. That won't be a sexy pick. I think Jaguars fans will look at this and say, "Oh, we're so unlucky. We didn't. Well, you got lucky last year.
The quarterback. Right.
So maybe this is just the flip side of that, where you didn't get lucky enough to have another franchise guy where you could have traded out. That would have been ideal.
Did you see
to go to trade down?
Did you see the clip of Evan Neal, the kid from Alabama, who 6'7", 350, leapt into the air and put one foot on a bag in front of him and one foot on a bag behind him, and the bags were 48 inches tall. I mean, so that's freak athleticism.
I did that on the way in this morning.
Well, I mean, but you're not 6'7", 360.
Pretty
close.
That one, aware.
Not only do I want an offensive tackle, that's who I want. Because he is massive and gifted, and you then move Walker Little over, move Juwan in, move Barch over, go with Linder, re-sign Shatley, whatever. I think you can fix the offensive line like that, and I think he is a special player. His height, his length, his footwork, his athleticism. You got really lucky last year that the quarterback was there. I think maybe years from now, if you take this kid, you'll think we got really lucky that a franchise caliber offensive tackle, a legitimate, not Luke Jokel, right? Or Eugene Monroe, but a legitimate guy was right there and we took him. So I'll say offensive tackle and specifically Evan Neal.
All right. We'll remember this in April. We'll come back to this.
I've done this before.
You have.
Yeah.
John, what do you got?
My this or that I turned into the staff wasn't very good. It's best free agent signing, Damian Wilson or anyone. I'll say Damian Wilson, but I'm going to go with another one. It's
always
the last,
do this.
It's the last show. There's no rules, Joe.
There's no rules.
We're off the rails.
There are rules you have to follow.
I'm going to go most important coaching trait, the thing that Judy talked about or anything else.
The connection.
Because I guess I want to go back to that because that was so insightful.
Yes. It was.
And it's so important, and I think it's a piece that often gets overlooked when people are analyzing this. They want to say, well, it was a defensive coordinator. Well, where did his defense rank last year? What has his success been? And when I was with Indianapolis, I talked to Tony Dungy about what made a great head coach. And he said the one thing that most owners miss is the qualifications for being a great coordinator, and he was a top-notch defensive coordinator, don't qualify you at all for being a head coach. It is an entirely different job, and too many owners say, well, we want this hot guy who has been the number one offense in the league, and he's got the goatee, Schlen, you know, beards and short haircuts are big for coaches right now, Schlen. They want that.
What's that? Are you available?
Well, yeah.
Are you playing left tackle?
If asked,
please,
I would call.
No.
So
communicate.
Right.
And that is the piece that misses so often. She hit the nail on the head. Mm-hmm. Owners must look for that piece who can lead. The X's and O's stuff, she said, was important. I guess it's important, But for a head coach, I'm not sure it's that important at all.
The connection part, the reason, if I'm not clear on this, I want a Mike Vrabel kind of guy, because the guys in Tennessee.
He communicates.
Talk about the way, and it's not just, she said something that we haven't said a lot, and we don't hear a lot, and that is that the coach is the heartbeat of your franchise, the face of the franchise is the quarterback, but the coach drives everything. And the whole building is more functional, right? This side of the hallway, the business side, works a whole lot more efficiently, energetically, enthusiastically. When the coach walks through here and says, hey guys, how is everybody today? Stops in ticketing to talk to the people who are on the phones and doesn't spend a lot of time, but knows a couple people's name and says, yeah, how's it going? What are you hearing, right? Drops the little nugget. Hey, don't be surprised if we don't really do a lot with the offensive line in free agency. Whatever. That connection, and not just in the locker room, but with his coaching staff and with the entire organization, is critical. Culture is not what you get your players to do. Culture is what you do and how you build it from within.
And those guys are special people. They're hard to find.
You bet they're hard to find. But Mike Vrabel is a star, not because he kept his team and got the number one seed, but because the way that organization responds to him. I mean, they don't need another coach for a really, really, really long time. He'll be there 15 to 20 years. He'll be the next Mike Tomlin.
Yeah, it is so true. And COVID has taken away some of that the past couple of years. And you see everyone kind of sit up a little straighter. It's just that presence.
You bet.
The presence that you need.
And enough concern to not walk by you and think, well, I'm the head coach. Don't you know me?
Yeah.
As to be the guy who says, how are you today?
Yeah.
Is a human being.
Yeah,
we
a
need
normal
that.
Dude.
We need that in this building in the worst way.
Yes, we do. All right, so Twitter has been a place lately. Brian, I know you're not on it.
Nope.
Gratefully so.
I'm very happy.
I'm just going to drop the bomb because it's just been
something
lately. I've
got an answer for
you. Okay, what is more dramatized? What is more overdramatic? What is the biggest overreaction? The Jaguars interviewing former Texans head coach Bill O'Brien, or keeping general manager Trent Baalke, which we have not been confirmed nor denied. That is just a report. What is the bigger overreaction from the fan base? Because, my gosh, it has been something lately.
Yeah, I mean, it's I guess I'm not sure what the big probably the big overreaction is to the Baalke stuff. To me, fans are going to do what fans do. They're going to get angry, and they have a right to be angry. The team has not been good for a long time. It's probably to the Trent thing because it's been a little over the top. But, you know, I get why fans are going to be quick trigger on something that has been associated with the franchise before because it hasn't been good. So I understand the fan reaction. At the same time, I firmly believe that ownership in any case must look at the facts, the details, must do the interviews, and then make decisions not based on what, you know, noise is going on. And I'm not diminishing the fans' feelings toward that, but it's ownership's responsibility to try to make the right decision and to not listen to noise as much as possible.
Well, the owner said last year that this was going to be a coach-centric organization, right? So... And I hold him to his word on that, that that's what he wants. I don't think he's necessarily changed his mind, which means that the coach is going to have the final say on what he wants. Now, that troubles me. In fact, I used the guy who used to be the head coach in Houston last year as the example of why you don't give a coach, right? Because he took apart a franchise that in 2019 looked like it was just a step below Kansas City and was going to be a long-time challenger. Mm-hmm. And that worries me. So I think the overreaction is to Baalke because... And I know he's got a reputation, but I don't know. Reputation is what others think of you.
Everyone has a reputation.
Character is who you really are. I don't know who he really is, okay? So I'm not going to judge him on that. But if the coach is the number one guy, I'm sure Trent Baalke can put a staff together that puts together a board that the coach can draw from if the coach knows what he's doing, right? The other guy worries me based on his recent history, and I just told you. I think Mike Vrabel is the kind of guy you want in this building. That's what Brian Sexton believes in. That's not Mike Vrabel. So I would say the overreaction is more towards Baalke because I think that the coach is the heartbeat of the franchise, and that's more critical to get right.
I like it. I'm glad we flushed that out. Yeah. I feel better now. I had to get it off my chest.
Good.
Thanks, fellas. And that is This or That, presented by Price.com. When we come back, July's headlines today, predicting very far in the future here on Jaguars Drive Time. Stay with us.
your family.
Design and production services for anything you need to enhance your brand, from custom signage to complete marketing solutions. Step up your game with Pinpoint and create the ultimate brand experience for your clients. Visit experiencepinpoint.com.
At ByStar Credit Union, you inspire us to deliver on our promise, to do good for our members and our communities. That's why we offer more banking options, like better rates and no hidden fees. We also give back, donating several million dollars to hundreds of nonprofits each year. Better financial lives, stronger communities. ByStar Credit Union. Do good. Bank better. Visit ByStarCU.org/join. Insured by NCUA.
Veterans, choose VA for the benefits you've earned. Visit choose.va.gov. We're back, Jaguars Drive Time, Wednesday brought to you by Jets Home Loans. We are going all the way to the start of training camp.
No. We're going to go back. You dropped the bomb and asked the question, and then you didn't answer it. I answered my question. John answered his.
I don't
you have
think
the guts
we normally
to ask the tough question.
Answer are this answer. Or that.
No, we
though.
Do. We did. We did today. We can roll the tape back if you'd like. Okay. But let's hear from you.
I think the this or that, the overreaction to Trent Baalke is by far the clear answer. I think it's underestimated how a general manager runs a day-to-day operation for a football team. We work in this building, so we see how the video department, the equipment staff, football operations, training, you name it, that reports normally to a general manager. I think it's underestimated how Trent Baalke has kept that cool in this building. I understand his reputation. I get that. I think people have made mistakes before. I think especially with the general manager openings you now see around the league, if you have a better name, for sure, name it. But I think the over-dramatized hype that you just have to get rid of Trent Baalke because he has a connection to Urban Meyer, I don't buy it.
No, he didn't have one before last year, so.
Right. Yeah. Better? Do we feel better now?
Well, no, look, you obviously thought about the answer when you wrote the question.
I did.
Right. We couldn't
I just thought we
by.
Were going a little long with the show.
Oh,
I was like, eh,
stop.
Might get to break. Why not?
Truth. The truth will set you free.
I feel so much better now.
All right, let's go to the future.
Let's go to the future. July, August, training camp. What's the headline, Brian?
Not all who wander are lost. The great J.R.R. Tolkien quote, and that is this franchise has been wandering, but I think that there will be a clear plan in place and that they'll be ready to start training camp focused and thinking about what is to come instead of dwelling on the past.
Well, I had two thoughts in my mind. One was New Year, same story. Now, I don't mean that it'll be the same story, but to me, the same goals that you had last year entering training camp have to be the same goals this year. Get out of the abyss, as I like to call it, start getting competitive, and by the end of 2022, feel like Trevor's going in the right direction, feel like it's there. I hoped that that would be the case by now. It's not, so you're still waiting for that. You have to get that first. Hopefully it's more than that, but that's the goal. I went with moving on up because I'm a positive.
Oh, here we go.
I'm a positive person. I like to see the glass half full. And I think next year is the year. They're picking number one for the second year in a row. I do think next year is the year that on the field you start seeing progress. You start seeing in October and November good wins that matter, that get you back in the hunt, as you guys like to be on the graphic.
I love that graphic.
I think you will start seeing steps toward that finally. It feels like you've been locked down for a long time. I think next year is the year they watch Lynn move on up.
One more thought on the graphic. I was sitting watching the game, right? And my boys were there, and they're like, whoa. Right? So many kids are growing up in this town without their team being on that graphic. You want to keep your future here? You got to be on the graphic.
Graphic's got a lot of ties. We put a lot of emphasis
on
that graphic.
Try and build a fan base without kids.
Yeah.
Good luck.
Good luck. I had promise as my July-August training camp headline. And similar to John, it's about the same headline that it was last year. And that's incredibly unfortunate, but you have to deal with it. It's going to be the same storyline because of all the hype, because of the one overall pick, because of the new head coach. That's where you're at. So prove it different. Promise.
Yeah, that's the reality. You've got to get... You're back to where you were.
Yep.
You have a new head coach. You have all the things. I mean, and you have the number one pick.
Yeah.
When you had the number one pick and you earned it, when you didn't trade for it, you're at the bottom. You've got to work up.
If they get this right, if ownership gets the coach right, this will turn quickly.
It will. And now we must thank everyone who has tuned into Jaguars Drive Time all season long. It has been a long dwelling season, and we have people come up to us and say we watch this show every single day. So thank you for tuning into Jaguars Drive Time all season long. Say something nice to our viewers.
Can't wait to see you in Publix.
Love the brute. I mean, love the viewers.
Yes. Can't wait to see
you. I may be a negative.
Well, I see them in Publix all the time, and people came and say, can you tell Ashlyn? No, I'm not telling Ashlyn.
No, you can talk to Ashlyn
yourself. You got to talk to her about her wardrobe yourself. Right?
Yourself, yeah.
So we'll see you in the aisles at Publix through the off season.
Love to hear it. Thank you for tuning in to Jaguars Drive Time. We will see you back after Super Bowl. Thank you to Joe Fortunato, all our producers, directors, everyone who works on this show. Thank you for tuning in all season. We'll see you soon.